Cultural practices can sometimes be used to modify the environment, making it less favorable to pest invasion, reproduction, survival, or dispersal. For instance, in some cases, simple changes in the timing of irrigation may reduce plant disease incidence or weed germination, or a change in planting or harvest time can allow a crop to escape pest invasion. Cultural pest controls complement other control options and are an essential component of IPM programs. Cultural controls are generally familiar, simple, and inexpensive, and they can often be incorporated into management systems with only minor modifications. Cultural pest control is most often used as a preventive pest management tool. To properly implement cultural control measures, it is essential to have a good understanding of crop and pest biology, ecology, and phenology, with special attention to weak links in the life cycle of the pest. I'm Dr. DeBusque, and in this video, I will go over different types of cultural control practices. Sometimes pest problems can be prevented by selecting a site that is pest-free or by choosing a crop, plant species, or variety that is particularly well-suited to the site. Before planting, evaluate whether the site and the resource being planted are a profitable match or whether the combination will create or aggravate pest problems. For example, trees or shrubs are often planted in landscapes without regard to the environmental conditions favorable to that plant. Plants poorly adapted to conditions at their site are more prone to insect and disease damage and generally do not perform well, such as these magnolias planted near the ocean and azaleas planted in poorly drained soil. Likewise, it is good management to avoid fields with weeds that are potentially troublesome and hard to control in a crop. Instead, plant an alternative crop where available herbicides, cultural practices, or crop competitiveness will help reduce troublesome weeds. Sampling for nematodes, propagules of potentially damaging pathogens, and weed seeds, and looking at the field history prior to planting can help determine whether the site is suitable for a given type of crop. Sanitation is an important management tool that is applicable in nearly every habitat and for most kinds of pests. Good sanitation practices minimize pests by removing or destroying their breeding, refuge, and overwintering sites or the pest species themselves. For instance, some plant pathogens cannot survive without a plant host. Removal of all residues from previous crops can limit future infestations. Some sanitation practices are effective enough that they eliminate the need for pesticide applications. For example, removal and destruction of mummy nuts from almond trees eliminates the overwintering sites of the navel orange worm. Important sanitation techniques for reducing pests includes 1. Use certified seed, tubers, or rootstock to prevent the spread of nematodes, weed seeds, and viral, bacterial, and fungal pathogens that may be carried in contaminated plant material. 2. Thoroughly clean with steam or pressurized water all equipment as it moves between different sites to prevent the spread of pathogens, nematodes, and weeds. 3. Use clean irrigation water. Do not irrigate with tailwater from fields infested with root knot nematodes or other soil-borne pathogens or pests. Do not use water that may carry runoff containing harmful herbicides. 4. Install screens in pipes, bringing irrigation water from canals or ditches to filter out seeds, rhizomes, and other weed parts. 5. Remove or clean up unharvested crops or areas that might provide overwintering habitat for pests. 6. Eliminate weedy borders. Destroying alternate hosts can effectively suppress certain pest populations. For example, some weeds or other plants act as alternate hosts for insect and pathogen pests. Destruction of these reservoirs can aid in suppressing pest populations. The control of curly top virus and sugar beets involves the destruction of weeds that are alternate hosts of the beet leafhopper. Lettuce root aphid overwinters in galls on poplar trees. Lettuce growers have successfully reduced populations of this aphid below damaging levels in their field by eliminating poplar windbreaks. For apples, a fungus, apple cedar rust, requires two hosts for survival. The elimination of cedar trees nearby apple trees can reduce the disease. Pest problems occur when conditions essential for survival, that is food, shelter, alternate hosts, and proper environmental conditions are favorable. Habitat modification intentionally changes the environment to limit availability of one or more of these requirements, thus reducing the suitability of the host to pest populations. Habitat modification is very important in vertebrate control. For example, weeds, ground cover, and litter provide food and cover for field mice. Eliminating these areas in and around crops, turf, and landscape in cultivated areas reduces the potential of these areas to support these and other vertebrate pests. Habit modification is effective in limiting numerous insect pests as well. For example, draining areas containing standing water reduces breeding sites for mosquitoes and is an important management technique. Smother crops are grown for their ability to suppress weeds and for their cash value. They are effectively employed in crop rotations following the main crop and are planted at high densities to rapidly occupy a site. Cereals, sorghum, safflower, field corn, and domestic sunflowers have been effectively used as smother crops. Cover crops are non-crop plant species grown either concurrently with the host crop, usually perennial plants, or in rotation with annual crops. They are generally not harvested. Cover crops can suppress weeds, provide nutrients to the soil, and provide food and shelter to beneficial insects, mites, and spiders. They are also valued for their ability to improve soil texture, increase organic matter, increase water infiltration rates, reduce pesticide runoff and surface water, and reduce soil erosion. In Florida, bahia grass and perennial pina is commonly used for perennial crops. In some cases, cover crops may compete with crops or become weeds if not properly managed. When using cover crops, it is important to select a species or mix of species that provides the specific benefits desired. Cover crop selection should take into consideration soil type, water availability, method of irrigation, cropping sequence, and cultural practices. Annual cover crops can be categorized into two main classes. One, crops that are adapted to cool short days, winter crops such as hairy vetch, and two, those that are adapted to hot long days, summer cover crops such as cowpea. Leguminous crops initially tend to grow slower than grass or grain crops and may not produce as much seasonal biomass, but they may add 60 to 200 pounds of nitrogen per acre per cropping season due to nitrogen-fixing bacteria. Inoculating the seed in the rhizobium bacteria may improve nitrogen production. Grass and grain crop decompose slower, adding more organic matter. Summer cover crops tend to generate more biomass than cool season leguminous crops, while on the other hand require adequate soil moisture, fertility, especially phosphorus, and a suitably high 6.0 to 6.5 soil pH to perform well. In Florida, nematodes are often managed through cover crops such as sun hemp, cowpea, marigolds, and sorghum sedan grass. Intercropping involves growing more than one crop in a field at the same time. Multiple crops are planted in alternating strips or intersown into a main crop. Intercropping is sometimes used to reduce pests. For instance, older stands of alfalfa can be overseeded with oats to reduce pest pressure, and the harvested alfalfa oat mix is sold as a forage crop. In cotton, a trap crop of alfalfa can be planted in strips to keep damaging ligus bugs out of the crop, since ligus does little damage to alfalfa hay grown for forage. Trap cropping uses plants attractive to insect pests to lure them away from the cash crop. Trap crops provide many benefits, including increasing crop quality, attracting beneficial insects, enhancing biodiversity, and reducing insecticide use. Trap crops can be planted around field perimeters or interplanted with the cash crop. A trap crop's effectiveness depends on what pests you are trying to manage and how desirable the host is for those pests. The trap crop should be planted at least 2 weeks before the main crop, since the reproductive structures, the flower and seeds, are the main attractor. It is best to use multiple trap crops and stagger them so that pests don't move off of the trap crops. For early spring cash crops, plant triticale in the fall for stink bugs. Sunflower, buckwheat, sorghum, and millet are recommended for the summer to fall period. For protection from the harlequin bug in cold crops, mustard can be used. One of the oldest cultural practices, crop rotation, is the intentional planting of specific crop sequences to improve crop health. It is widely practiced to increase organic matter, improve soil properties, conserve water, and manage pests. Crop rotation have provided effective control for certain host-specific plant pathogens, nematodes, and insects by disrupting the plant's life cycle and by changing environmental conditions to deter certain species. Good candidates for management by crop rotation include soil and root-dwelling nematodes and soil-borne pathogens that do not produce airborne spores and have limited host ranges. When rotation is used, alternate weed hosts must be controlled as well. Grains are routinely used as parts of a crop rotation sequence. In the sod-based crop rotation project at the North Florida Research and Education Center, a 160-acre field is divided into quadrants and rotated with 2 years of bahia grass, followed by a year of peanuts and then a year of cotton. This system has shown long-term benefits in soil health, reduced pest pressure, and increased crop yields. Planting and harvest dates should be chosen to favor crop development and discourage pests. For weed management, choose a planting time that favors germination of the crop over key weed species. For instance, in many parts of California, fall alfalfa planting can be adjusted to avoid both late germinating summer weeds and late fall germinating winter weeds. However, crops planted too late in fall will germinate and grow slowly, allowing winter weeds to become well established. In fields that are infested with field bindweed, perennial grasses or nutsedge planted in early fall will ensure that alfalfa is established and vigorously growing when these perennials start growing in spring. Adjustments in timing of planting can also aid in insect and disease management. Winter-grown carrots and potatoes can be planted when the potato cyst nematode is not active, avoiding exposure in early crop development stages when the pest is the most damaging. Harvest can also be timed to limit or avoid pest damage. Early harvest varieties reduce the number of generations and minimize crop-to-crop overlap in some crops. Poor water management is a major contributor to many pest problems. Excess soil water excludes oxygen that plant roots need to survive and is a primary factor in the development of many root and crown diseases, such as Phytophthora root rot. Excess water and poor drainage in low areas of fields or landscapes also favor numerous hard-to-control weeds, such as nutsedge and barnyard grass. Underwatering or drought stress, on the other hand, may cause wilting, sunburns, sun scald, and branch cracking that can allow invasion of pathogens and attract boring insects. And it can stress plants to the extent that they cannot overcome attack by pests. This is especially true of conifers. Certain types of irrigation systems are both positively and negatively associated with pest populations. Droplets from overhead irrigation can dislodge, drown, or drive some insect mite pests and reduce powdery mildew, but it can also encourage fruit and foliar diseases. Drip irrigation systems deliver water only to sites where it is needed, reducing diseases and weeds. To avoid problems associated with over or underwatering, learn the water requirements of the plants and learn how much water the soil can hold. Schedule the frequency and amount of irrigation using weather-based methods or by measuring soil moisture. Fertilizers and soil amendments are applied to promote healthy plants and increase yields. Although not a pest management practice, the use of fertilizers and soil amendments can influence the activity of many pest species to the advantage or detriment of the host plant. It has been argued that healthy plants have a greater tolerance to pest attack and damage. While this may be true, over-fertilization may attract or enhance development of many pest species. Excess nitrogen on nectarines, for example, results in increased levels of brown rot, oriental fruit moth, and peach twig borer. Excess nitrogen levels are also a contributing factor in the incidence of large patch, a common disease in St. Augustine grass. Aphids, leafhoppers, lace bugs, and other sucking insects are associated with the lush growth that results from excess nitrogen application. Adding the proper amounts of soil nutrients when the plant needs them greatly assists pest management practices and limits environmental contamination from excess nitrogen, especially nitrogen loss from leaching to groundwater. In conclusion, this video went over the various types of cultural controls and can be used as part of an integrated pest management program.